You don't need to search for long to discover Blythe Pepino, the famous pop star, 100% British. A zillion views on the internet, just like that. We love her. Her life is like a fairy tale. Listen to this. But now, out of the blue for our fans, this fairy tale is taking an unexpected turn. Don't get us wrong, a hit is a hit, but her new songs sound totally different.
I'm sorry, my friends. I didn't want to stop you when you were having such a fine time. But this is an emergency.
We had been waiting for one of those new cool Blythe Pepino clips, but instead she suddenly appeared on national television, talking about this thing called BirthStrike.
Right, first today, you might have considered recycling your rubbish or no longer buying disposable coffee cups to help save the planet, but would you ever consider giving up your chance to be a parent?
So, Blythe, you're 32, you're an environmentalist, you're a singer-songwriter, and it was this weekend, just gone, actually, that you started BirthStrike. So tell us what it is and why you did that.
That's right. So last year, I really became very aware of what's happening with our ecological collapse of the natural environment. And I was so concerned about that. It was actually quite bad timing because I'd just come to the point with my partner where we were discussing having a family.
Right.
The concern for pretty much all of the BirthStrikers that have joined our little group...
90 so far.
So far, yeah, that's right. Is that there isn't going to be a future for those children. So, really, we're talking about a scale of a crisis which is so unprecedented, and there's so much about it which is terrifying.
You have to give it to her. She got our attention. But it is also very confusing. If we stop giving birth, would the world really become a better place?
It's not the time to be thinking about having a family. I've made this decision to not have children, which is a very emotional decision for me, especially because I'm in love and I love my partner and I would like to imagine that family future. It was in a really exciting part of the first part of our relationship. It was like, you know, every time we made love, it was like, maybe we're gonna make babies together in the future. It was a biological, like, urge. And now I struggle with that. At the end of my sort of pop career, I ended up being very aware of the refugee crisis in Calais and decided to come out to volunteer. I met my partner, Josh, here. It means that the crisis on our borders is very much a part of both our relationship and my life, I suppose. As far as I remember, you couldn't see any of the grass, so it was just completely covered in structures and people. And vehicles, and I mean, there were kind of mini shops and all kinds of things.
The refugee camp was located right here in Calais. But as far as we can remember, we cleared out the whole area with the help of our French friends. We stopped those refugees from coming to Britain. But somehow, the whole situation must have triggered Blythe to decide not to get pregnant.
What I see happening in microcosm on the border here is like a small, horrific version of what could happen across the world, I think. There's going to be several things happening. We'll be losing land, both to sea and also to desertification. So basically mass displacement, mass loss of food creation. And we're looking at war as a result of people losing their homes, losing their security. And I'm also really worried about massive temperature rises causing natural disasters. I think that's what scares me the most.
OK, we can worry about everything all the time, but we also need to look at the bright side of life. Don't we humans eventually solve most problems? Honestly, the future is not that bleak. Even a climate psychologist would agree that we need to stay positive.
You offered me something to be optimistic about. You were trying to cheer me up, I think. But I think maybe you're trying to cheer yourself up as much as anything else. I sometimes say to people who tell me that climate change isn't happening, I will say, well, I'd really love it if you're right. I would be so pleased if you were right. But I think it's quite an unsafe place to be, and that somewhere in it there's a lot of anger and a lot of fear. They don't want to hear what I've got to say. They just want to tell me that this isn't true. Behind your feeling of absolute conviction that climate change is not happening is a fear that maybe you're wrong. You're kind of nodding now, as if you might almost accept what I've said, that actually one thing maybe you and I can agree on is that this issue makes us both very upset and very angry and quite fearful.
I feel afraid of what's happening and what's coming towards us, and I feel afraid because I'm not preparing. I feel like our society, our tribe, is not preparing. You know, you can handle a threat if you feel that you are doing everything you can to prepare. And then if you die, you die. If the hunger comes, it comes. Right now, it feels so out of control because there isn't this group effort. It's like a small group of activists going, ah! And then everyone else is like, yeah, it's bad. And that's it. Like, okay, that's terrifying. I'm sorry, my friends. I didn't want to trouble you. I believe this is happening. When you were happy. And because I believe it's happening, it definitely makes me feel depressed. But this is an emergency. The waters are climbing. And if we do not rise up now, then we will soon be drowning.
You talk of feeling quite depressed.
I'm sorry, my...
And that troubles me to hear that. The place I think that you need to move to is from being in a state of terror to being in a state of action.
But this is an emergency.
Action is the antidote to despair.
And so we have to rise up now.
Maybe it's true. Most of us do not really think too much about the climate. Although we do care, but what do you expect us to do? Do you want us all to get arrested, to stay childless, to stop enjoying life? She does not have a solution either, except going on strike. And what about that boyfriend? Has he given up fatherhood altogether?
I can't force them to be aware. I want to pull them into my way of thinking. But I said that to Josh. I said, like, I feel like I have a duty to tell you this, to show you this stuff, and He's already on the front line, and he was worried, I think, that I would want him to change his life. It's just about wanting to have the same psychological foundation.
I'm not going to let myself sort of mourn fatherhood because I don't want to have children right now anyway. It's something that I would like in the future. And I suppose there's an element of hope in there anyway, isn't there still? There's still an element of hope in some way that, like, I don't know, maybe there is for me and maybe there isn't for you, I don't know.
But we are in a different place in that sense, I guess.
Yeah,
a little bit.
I think so. But it's also not something that, like, I don't know, we've also both spoke hopefully there and said, like, yeah, let's hope that one day is possible.
Mm. Yeah.
I think it's absolutely true that to bring a child into the world is to bring another person who will need to use a lot of carbon in their life. But sometimes I wonder whether it isn't also a piece of relinquishment that embraces death. And I want people to find a way of embracing life as we face this extraordinarily difficult situation.
Eerlijk gezegd, het klimaat is natuurlijk maar zeer ten dele een persoonlijk probleem. Het is bovenal een gigantisch politiek probleem dat politici echter nauwelijks kunnen hanteren, omdat het alle grenzen in ruimte en tijd overschrijdt. Je kunt teruggaan naar de oude tijden of je voortplanting naar de toekomst afsluiten. Maar er is meer nodig, veel meer, en dat weten we allemaal.